The committee tasked to realign the confidential and intelligence funds of civilian agencies set to submit their proposal today. Congresswoman Janet Garin, the vice chairperson of the House Committee on Appropriations, says the panel began their deliberations right after Congress went into recess last week, but she refused to say which agencies will see their surveillance funds either slashed or reduced. Garin admits, though, asking for secret funds became the trend among government agencies.
Ang daming nakiuso at naabuso na rin. No? I mean, I'm not referring to the OVP or DepEd, but if you look at the historical data, the jump started in 2017, where the total confidential fund in 2016 was 720 million. In 2017, It jumped to 2.07 billion. At makikita mo, pagdating ng 2020, it more than doubled to 4.57 billion. Tumaas ng tumaas yung confidential fund. Pero ngayon, ang nakikita natin is tila hindi siya napunta sa mga tamang ahensya.
House leaders vowed to realign the secret funds of civilian agencies following intense scrutiny on its use. For another lawmaker, aside from the Philippine Coast Guard, agencies going after drug syndicates also deserve an increase in intelligence funds.
It's still a significant amount that they enjoy, you know, so to speak. But we still need more. Because you're fighting a syndicate. It is a global syndicate. So it's not very easy to catch them without having intelligence funds. So there is a need, really, to increase the budget of the intelligence operatives in the law enforcement units.
Congressman Barbers, well, he's renewing his call for the reimposition of the death penalty in the country to curb the illegal drug trade. Barbers made that proposal even as he believes the drug situation in the country has improved.
Could be a deterrent. That's why there is really a need to study the revival of the death penalty proposal so that if we really want to address the problem of illegal drugs. A lot of massive apprehensions made by the law enforcers during this administration. This is a continuing program. They continued the programs of the last administration. It is fair to say that it is improved.
Barbers, who is the chairperson of the House Committee on Dangerous Drugs, also wants stronger measures imposed in Subic, Zambales following the discovery of billions worth of shabu entering the area. He adds, a House hearing into the Subic drug haul will be scheduled.
Stiffer penalty, because we believe that, you know, if Subic is being used as a way to all these illegal drugs, there are people in the Subic area that are in cahoots with the syndicates. So if for penalties, once we catch them, then maybe we start the process. I'm glad that the DOJ is on top of this. There are information as well that there are foreigners that are behind the schemes. There are foreigners here that can do that in the country. I would surmise that they are in cahoots with some local officials in the area. So death penalty is one. So second, intelligence community. No? We need information also from the public. The law enforcers cannot just do it alone.
Philippine economic managers might lower their growth target for this year. That's according to Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno, citing a slowdown in the country's GDP growth in the second quarter. His remark comes after the Asian Development Bank downgraded its 2023 growth forecast for the Philippines to 5.7% from 6%. Diokno also warns of possible revenue losses after some fiscal reforms failed to hurdle Congress. Despite this, Diokno says the government has other options to fund next year's 5.7 trillion peso national budget, including the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund. The economic leaders will announce possible growth adjustments during their next budget coordination meeting on October 19th. Businesses in Central Visayas warn of possible layoffs due to the wage hike in the region, which takes effect today. Our very own Annie Perez now joins us with that story. Annie, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, that's right. Starting today, workers in Central Visayas region will get an adjustment of 33 pesos for their daily wage. This came after the approval of Wage Order Number 24 in the Regional Tripartite Wage and Productivity Board in Central Visayas signed 2 weeks ago. However, businesses are indeed worried on this move. Based on the order, Class A areas will now have a minimum wage of 468 pesos for non-agricultural establishments and 458 for agricultural establishments for less than 10 workers. For Class B areas, it will be 430 and 425. For Class C areas, it's 420 for agricultural establishments and 415 for non-agriculture. The scheme shall be applied to all minimum wage earners within Bohol, Cebu, Negros Oriental, and Siquijor, regardless of position, designation, or status of which their wages are paid. However, for the Cebu Chamber of Commerce and Industry, they said that possible layoffs could be in effect due to the increase in wage. Its president, Charles Kenneth Co, explained that some labor-intensive industries, especially there in the Mactan Export Processing Zone, will be adversely affected. But they do hope that no job losses will happen, especially this year. They explained that laborers earning the minimum wage should also look into upskilling themselves in these times so that it would not be so skill-dependent, especially in the areas of digitalization because these are high-paying job opportunities. Co assured, however, that the chamber and government agencies like TESDA and DTI will continue to have programs in this so-called upskilling. Co is also encouraging parents to put their children through education so that they won't get left behind and be stuck with low-paying jobs. Earlier, some labor groups already said that the 33 pesos increase is not enough. For instance, the Alianza ng mga Mamumuo sa Sugbo, KMU, Chairperson Jaime Paglinawan said that the 33 pesos is not even enough to cover basic commodities and payment of services. They will continue to lobby for a 100 to 292 peso increase, which they did already in the first quarter of the year, and they will also continue to call for a unified wage across the regions and hope that it will be made into a law soon. And that's the latest here from Central Visayas. Ani Perez, ABS-CBN News.
The Bureau of Customs filed several complaints against alleged rice importers linked to a warehouse which is raided in Bulacan. The charges include economic sabotage and violations of the Customs Monetization and Tariff Act. They stemmed from warehouse inspections conducted by customs agents back in August. Meanwhile, the BOC has also discovered over 236,000 sacks of rice in Bulacan in four different warehouses late last week. Warrants of seizure and detention were issued on suspicion the grains were smuggled and being hoarded. President Marcos and his economic manager set to convene this week to decide on the possible lifting of the price cap on rice. Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno says President Marcos's decision will depend on the status of the country's rice supply and harvest. Marcos ordered the price cap last month amid surging costs of the staple grain. This also prompted Diokno and NEDA Chief Arsenio Balisacan to propose cutting rice import tariffs, which the president has turned down. Well, a bit of good news for motorists. A second straight week of oil price rollback set for Tuesday. After an 11-week streak of fuel price increases, gasoline will see the biggest price cut of 2 pesos per liter. Kerosene prices will also go down by 50 centavos, while a liter of diesel will see a 40 centavo markdown. Meanwhile, prices of cooking gas up for the third straight month this October. LPG prices increased by as much as 3 pesos and 75 centavos per kilogram.